Ham Radio Now, episode 49. I'm going to stare straight ahead and not pay any attention to that title flying through, trying to distract me. Well, I guess I could look down and read it. Using D-Star high and low speed data modes. And this one is going to be presented by John Davis, WB4QDX. And once again, it's a talk from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference down in Orlando way back last September. Well, we've done a lot of them, so we've been pretty busy. You know, I think most D-Star users only use the digital voice part of D-Star. They may know there's the possibility of sending some data, and that would be text, images, or binary files, but they don't actually use it. They may not even realize that the data part of D-Star is always part of their signal every time they transmit, whether they're using it or not. So in this talk from the 2012 ARRL and TAPR DCC, John Davis, WB4QDX, will be digging into the two data modes available on D-Star, and that is the low-speed one that's part of every voice transmission at about 1,200 bits per second, and the high-speed one that is only available on 1,200 megahertz using the ICOM ID1 transceiver, and that is 128 kilobits per second. He'll tell us about the software and the hardware that is needed to make this work. And I already need to correct myself because the high-speed mode is also going to be available on a new radio from a company called NW Digital. It's a digital radio that'll run in the 70-centimeter band. Brian Hoyer, K7UDR, talked about that radio back in episode 37. And we also talked to him back at the Orlando Hamfest in an interview. Now, on the ID1, the high-speed data rate is 128 kilobits per second. On the NW Digital radio, it's going to be half of that, 56 kilobits per second. But it's going to be the same high-speed data format. And one of the things that's limiting it, I'm not sure what's limiting it inside the radio, maybe something is, but on the 70-centimeter band, we have a 100 kilohertz cap on bandwidth dictated by the FCC for data. Now, if you're running video, you can go beyond that, whether the video is analog or digital. But if you're just sending binary files and data text and stuff like that, this is part of those rules that have not really caught up with the technology that we have today. So 56 kilobits on the NW digital radio, but it's still going to be the D-Star high-speed data mode. So that'll be cool. All right, well, while I'm interrupting myself, I'm going to plug John Davis's D-Star training seminar that he gave that is also a Ham Radio Now episode. He put the seminar on in conjunction with the Dayton Hamvention last year. It's a three-hour class on using D-Star, and it's all online, part of Ham Radio Now episode 12. So if you're interested in D-Star and haven't checked out that episode, that three-hour training seminar, you can go back and do that too. I think John might be doing the class again this year as part of the Hamvention. So if you're going to be there, you might be able to take that live. It's not actually, at least last year, it was not actually at the Hamvention. It was at a hotel a couple miles away on Friday morning. So you missed some of the Hamfest, but it's worth it if you want to get some live demonstration and tutorial on how to do this D-Star thing. I haven't seen any announcement on it on the dstarinfo.com website, but that's the place to go for any updates. So go check that out if you want to take part of this program. I guess I should also remind you while I'm interrupting things that Ham Radio Now is viewer supported. Arvin up there overlooking everything says stop by hamradionow.tv and click his icon, and whatever the program is worth to you, you can make a contribution, and we thank you for doing that. Things have been going pretty good this year, so we're a long way from our goal, a long way from making this actually a full-time deal, but getting better and better all the time. So thank you very much if you have contributed, and if you've been watching a lot and haven't, think about doing that. Again, whatever it's worth to you. All right, all the interruptions are out of the way. Let's get back to Atlanta for John's talk. Wait, one more thing. This is the last of the regular talks from the DCC. We've used them all up. We got the banquet keynote address to put together, and that'll be coming up maybe end of this week or early next week. And then we've got the four-hour deep dive into GNU Radio. That's GNU, GNU Radio. And that will take us right up to the edge of the Orlando Hamcation. And Jeff, AC4ZO, and I are planning on going down to Orlando and doing lots of interviews and looking around the Hamfest. So that was the beginning of Ham Radio Now last year. So we'll be celebrating our actual one-year anniversary of Ham Radio Now when we go down to the Hamcation. So maybe we'll see you there if you're taking vacation and heading down to Orlando in February. All right, back down to Atlanta. Steve Bible, introduce John Davis, please.
Continuing with the digital voice theme, up next, John Davis, WB4QDX, using D-Star low and high speed data.
I come bearing good news. I'm the only thing keeping you from happy hour. So we'll make this as short as we can. Thank you. Any questions? All right, continuing on with the D-Star side of this, and I'll focus today on the data side. Keep in mind there are two different data speeds that you can use within D-Star. And following on with what Mo said earlier, the entire D-Star data stream over the air is 4,800 BPS, 2,400 of that is the voice with another 1,200 for forward error correction, and that leaves approximately 1,200, a little less than that, kind of packet speed data is allocated strictly for data use. Every D-Star radio that's commercially produced right now has a serial port included, so you don't have to do the level conversion like you've had to do on some previous ICOM and Yaesu radios. It's a transmit, receive data, and ground, a three-pin connection on every one, so you can go direct serial. In fact, it's very easy to connect for the low speed data, and I'm going to demonstrate this a little bit later, but I have my handheld with a serial cable, and that's plugged into the serial port. My PC is old enough that it actually has still a serial port. So one cable makes an easy connection without having to have anything outboard such as a TNC. And it will work simplex or through repeaters or linked repeaters through reflectors, because as you saw, Wimo had the diagram and has been presented earlier also, that voice and data are traveling together. So it the repeaters do not differentiate whether it is voice or data as far as the bit stream passing through it. And that's also important. One of the comments that's always made with D-Star, especially in kind of an emergency communications mode, is, well, it depends on the internet. If the internet goes out, it's useless. Well, that's not exactly true, because yes, if you want to link over longer distances, yes, you will need the internet for that. But you also have your local repeater coverage, and most emergencies tend to be local in nature, with few exceptions. So you do have your local repeater coverage. Repeaters do go out, no matter what flavor they are. So you still have the simplex capabilities with the full voice and data transmission. Now I'm going to focus for a few minutes on low speed data. And when using that, I actually have a slide or a bullet that I should be talking about as well. In that low speed data stream, you can do two things, or at least two, I would say. One would be, you can transmit position data, GPS data. Some of the ICOM radios have GPS built in. The brand new 31A handheld, 440 only handheld, but that's going to be released as a dual band in the next few months, has a built-in GPS with a GPS antenna. So using that 1200 baud data stream, you can actually transmit position information along with your voice. Now, that's kind of handy because you don't have to have, again, another radio or TNC or Tiny Track or whatever it may be to transmit your position data. That goes along with you. The other side of that would be for just transmitting raw data in different formats. But remember, when using data for that, you need to disable the GPS sections of the menu so that your programs, and I'll talk about one of those in a minute, can actually use the data program and disable the GPS functions. Low-speed data, Mo mentioned this, I think, as well, that there is no error correction on the low-speed data part. Fortunately, some of the programs that you will use in transmitting, for example, for file transfer, and we're going to actually show the DRATS program, which is an example of that. Some error correction is built into the application itself so that your transmissions can be more reliable. And again, simplex or through local or linked repeaters, regardless there. And again, the GPS position data runs simultaneous if you are running that either. For example, the ICOM IC92AD that I have has an external GPS speaker mic. Some of the newer models, you'll start seeing that built in. Easy connection to the radio. One cable, the first one, when I bought my first D-Star handheld, I took a couple hours in the basement. Once I finally got the pins right on that and stopped reversing them, it was a single homemade cable. Commercial cables are much better than the ones I can make on the bench, so I've actually purchased a couple of those. But the point of single cable attachment from either a laptop, netbook, or your desktop, whatever, to your radio. One of the best programs, and I was kind of slow to come on board with this program, is written by Dan Smith, KK7DS, out in Oregon. DRATS is a easy to use, and it's a multi-platform, and one of the things that's most important to hams, it's free. And Dan has put an awful lot of work into this, and it really is kind of, I'll borrow one of Robin's terms, it's kind of the Swiss Army knife of D-Star data, because it will provide the messaging function, email, file transfer, mapping, and the position reporting. So it's a very handy program. It is free, it's available, it's always being enhanced, so we'll probably have some new features coming as well. DRATS is probably the easiest way. At a minimum, you can connect your laptop to your radio and on the other end have the same configuration and use just a simple communications terminal program, the right baud rate and parity settings, et cetera, and just do keyboard to keyboard. Well, that's okay, but generally we like to do a little bit more in that. So DRATS combines those functions, which make many of those capabilities very attractive for emergency communications. You can also use DRATS or a number of programs, APRS programs, to display positions. And one of the reasons is that you can use other programs, is that most of the repeaters will gate that APRS-like data coming from the D-Star data stream into the APRS network so that those can be displayed with programs like APRS.fi and others that that collect that data. The DRATS program itself is multi-platform, works on a variety, Windows, Mac, and Linux. You do have multiple interfaces, and one of the things is if you do not have a D-Star radio, you can still use DRATS because it will support just an internet connection. If you wanted to go between two computers that are internet connected, you don't even have to have a radio. There's another module within the package of software that you download called Repeater Proxy. However, most people call it a ratflector because it functions as a reflector function. You can hook a radio to one port on your computer have an internet connection on the other, and you can gate between a local radio and those stations operating on the internet. Now, another feature that I thought was especially attractive, although I haven't had time to really look into it, is the ability to operate with the AX25 protocol, and therefore you could go into a KISS TNC. Now, where that would become very, very powerful, and I look at it from an MCOM perspective, is that I could connect a KISS TNC, a KPC3 or something on one side, I could connect a D-Star radio on the other side, and in theory, they could talk using a common program. And I think that's one of the things in a lot of what we do, especially in emergency communications, that gets complex. Some will like WinLink, some will like Outpost, some will like keyboard to keyboard, and on and on and on. And with a full function platform like this, that can be very powerful. The functions within DRATs that use the low-speed data messaging, you can send, there are pre-formatted forms or message forms within it, like an NTS radiogram. There's ICS 213, and you can build custom forms. And what happens is you have that form template on each end. You fill in the form, and it can look like more like the regular paper form itself. Transmit the raw data, not the entire graphics of the form, etc., which makes it attractive for the low-speed data function. It's then populated on the other end, and then that gives you a form in a readable format to be able to print off and, for example, hand to your served agency or whoever. The chat function is just that, and we'll see one of the screens. File transfer, and I'll use a key word here, unattended file sharing. That function looks an awful lot like an FTP program. You'll see your local side, remote side, you connect to a distant computer via radio, internet, whatever. And then a folder is designated on each one, and you see the contents of each of those folders. And so it's drag and drop file transfer between those, and I don't have to have someone on the other end to go grab a file or to upload a file to that other end. So that becomes very attractive. Then, of course, the mapping and position reporting functions, the maps, are included within the program. All right, with Ed's assistance in the back, he's actually duplicating the exact setup I have here. He has a radio connected to the serial port. And let me bring up the DRATS program. And you'll see down at the bottom here in the lower left, it says I'm connected to a 92AD. Oop, off the screen. That's better. So what I have done in the preferences, I have set up, and I can go to multiple types of interfaces, and I have a bunch set up here for the different radios I may have, but you see I have on COM1 set up, and if I expand this box, I've labeled it as my 92AD. So I have that checked, and now anything coming in will be used in the program itself. And I'll put that up there because you might be able to see either a red or a green light to show that it's transmitting or whatever. Now, you also see that the outer borders of this are flashing, which means there's been some activity within the program. And so I'm going to go over suspecting that it's the chat window, and I see WA4YH in the back of the room lying to me, telling me he's in Germany, which he's not quite that far away. Now, Ed, if you'll send another message, and you'll see, you'll probably see it a little green light flash on here. And then his message comes through, and I've never believed much that he ever says. But I will transmit something back to him, which you do on the lower line here. And we're doing this all by radio, no repeaters involved, so this is strictly a simplex operation. And that's going to be sent to him. And I will assume he receives it, and he'll probably answer me back with that. This is the chat window. there's no error correction needed on this. You're just sending back and forth, and whoever is on the frequency can use this. So he's answered back with that. Now, the function that I really, really like in this is file transfer. Now, what you see are two sides of the screen. And if you look over on the right side, up here at the top, you see stations. Now, because your call sign is transmitted with each D-Star transmission, it knows your call sign. However, in the program itself, you can set up a non-call sign type of identification, such as a tactical call sign. So if you're using this for some type of emergency communication support, that might be EOC, shelter, one, church, school, whatever it may be. And I have my call sign set up in it for this. Now I can do a couple of functions from here. Number one, I can, well, first off, I'm going to clear the screen, and then I'm going to ping him, and that's going to tell me who's out there right now. And his call sign shows right back up there. So he answered me back, and any other station that was on this frequency, or if I were connected to the internet, would show as well. Now, I've designated a folder on the left side, and I've got two files. One's a very small one, and then I have another one in there that's a little larger, 11 kilobytes. Now, I'm not connected to him, and I haven't done anything to initiate a download to me, but he has just downloaded another file. Did you see the bottom one come in, and that's an 11 kilobyte file. Takes maybe half a minute or so to send something like that. You obviously don't want to send big files because of the speed, very similar to packet. And I can upload to him in the same direction. So if I want to connect to him, I'm going to go WA4YIH, connect, watch the lower line for status, connecting to WA4YIH. And then it should turn to connected. It does. And I see what's in his directory, his designated folder on his computer. Now, if I want to send, I'm just going to send this very short one up to him. And I'm going to say upload. And you can watch the file transfer status at the bottom. It first polls, see if it's there, establishes communication, sends it, and negotiates, and then sends it, and it's gone. And you'll see it, the screen update and show on his end in just a little bit. But the whole idea behind this is that it makes it very easy, and you don't have to worry about all the intricacies of this. This looks like an FTP program. The email, which if I go over to it, I was waiting for that to finish just to show, and you see that the file shows up on the other side, read from his side. I can go to messages, and this looks like many of the email type programs that you would see out there with an inbox, outbox, sent, and trash. Now, if I want to do a new message, I can do a few things with this. I can send it as an email message, which then goes out over the internet to get to someone, but if it knows that that call sign is available on the network, then it will, I can send by just addressing it by call sign. Now, if I want to send a new email message, and destination call sign here would be WA4YIH, subject test, and we'll keep it short with test again. And I'm going to send. That will show up in the outbox, and that should, you can have it where it automatically sends. I don't remember whether I have it set up that way in here or whether I need to do a send receive. Just for short order, I'll make sure that happens. So you see that initiating on the status line at the bottom of the screen, and that will send that message to him. He can send something back to me as well. So that function works well. Within this, if there is a station that is within contact with you that has internet access, you can also send Windlink messages from within its program. So that can be handy as well. That's basically the message function. I won't go into the mapping. That's a little more difficult to see, but the whole purpose is that DRATS is a free program. Very well written and distributed, easily available out there. Has a lot of functionality in there, which is very nice to be used in a lot of different applications. And that sure makes, that cleans up the use of the low-speed data. Simplest form, as I said, I could have just your terminal program that would just set it to the right baud rate, and I would have that, and you just chat back and forth keyboard to keyboard much as you do. Now, he's sending me a message right now as well, so I'm going to switch over to the inbox and be monitoring there. And when that message comes in, it'll show up in my inbox just like it normally would on an email program. So that's very simply that program, and I do invite you, even if you're not a D-Star user, it's a great program that could be used for communicating even just within the internet. But I do want to be able to check out. I have not had the opportunity, because I was bugging Dan Smith for a long time, that I think it would be very powerful, because not everyone has a D-Star radio, not everyone has a TNC or packet-based radio, but if there's some way you could bridge those, that would be pretty powerful. And so he's included the basics of the AX25 protocol in that, and I think that's going to allow more of that sharing by using a common program. All right, let me move on to, pardon?
Open your message.
Open my message. Oh, that's dangerous. Do I trust him? I know I don't, but I'm going to do it anyway.
Do email filtering to keep some of this out?
I don't have a spam filter on this, so I received the message from him. And even though he misspelled anything, it's, you know, we're doing pretty well with this. Can't compensate for operator error. All right. He's using, or using a very similar one, a handheld. You're using the 91 or the 80? The IC91, which was the predecessor to this one, which is a IC92. Again, all of them are single cable to interface with that. All right, back to PowerPoint. And all right, let's talk about the other side of the data capabilities within D-Star, and we move up to the 1.2 gigahertz band, where there's a lot more spectrum available to us. And for those of you who are not familiar, the amateur portion of that, I think, mainly runs from 1240 to 1300 megahertz. The band plan is a good size, where that multiple bandwidths and multiple modes are usually included for those operating in the 1.2 band. We've seen ATV repeaters, crossband links, and there are some pure 1.2 voice repeaters in that band. Now, the thing to keep in mind, how many people have actually done some experimenting transmitting in the 1.2 band? One thing you find out pretty quick, it doesn't go very far, especially if you have trees in the middle, right? It is much more of a line of sight mode and band, frequency band. Your free space loss is much higher. You are affected more by obstructions. Just as an example, the free space loss calculation at 5 miles, you can see, is about 20 dB more than it is at 2 meters. So that can have a lot of impact on your path and whether you have a reliable path. It's kind of interesting, and I'll show one of the applications where we have actually used the high-speed data. But we had to go back as we were designing or laying out frequency plans for many of the Georgia repeaters that we were implementing. We had to go back and rethink our frequency plan, because we thought, you know, they're only going to go, we're going to have sites that are about 50 to 75 miles apart. We can probably have two frequencies and just reuse those throughout the state. But then we thought about doing things from the air, from airplanes. And things changed after that. We'll talk a little bit more about that. The 1.2 gigahertz radio that's commercially available from ICOM is the ID1. Now, it will operate FM voice. It will also operate the regular GMSK mode, which gives you the voice and low-speed data. But then it also has a mode that will allow you to transmit the higher speed data. It's relative in today's term, since people are now getting 50 to 100 megabits download speed at their house. 128 kilobits doesn't sound like a lot, but over radio, it can be more than we've been used to. This radio has a 10 watt transmit output. In the high speed data mode, it actually has an RJ45 Ethernet connector. So it is acting as an Ethernet wireless bridge. Now you can use that for repeaters that are equipped with a what we call a DD or digital data mode module on them. You can actually have internet connectivity through them. Or if you need something for last mile, have two radios, they can connect together. For example, you may be, and I think about some disaster scenarios where the internet is out in this area, but I can get it to right here, which is at kind of the edge of the affected area. Now I may put an ID1 radio here with a gain antenna, a directional antenna, point it a few miles in to a site, and I can bridge that IP connectivity into that location. So I can actually create that wireless bridge between two points. Now, when you're communicating through the DD module on the repeater, you are assigned, when you register on a system, a 10 address that is internal to the network, but you need to know that as you are addressing with a computer that's addressing that ID1. Radio itself does not have an IP address, but you're assigned that in the database of registered users. We have actually used the high-speed data with internet connectivity during a simulated emergency test exercise in our ARES group here in the Atlanta area. We had a need to transmit some files and photos. We were actually simulating, now this is odd, it was the middle of the worst drought in the Southeast in years, and we were simulating flooding. Leave it to the hams to do that. We found where the low water marks were during this, though. So we actually went out, and you'll see one of the pictures here is a stream gauge, and so that we could provide proof to our EMA director that we were actually on site and read that stream gauge, we took a photo and sent it back over 1.2 in the DD mode. I'll share a short story with you that actually sold our county and eventually Georgia Emergency Management Agency on the use of the high-speed data and the D-Star technology. This site that you see with the fence, what you cannot see, there's a bridge just beyond that gate. We were going out to measure the stream gauge under that bridge. The group went out to the site. They couldn't get to the bridge. There's a gate across it with a stop sign. We said, you must be in the wrong location. Well, we'll send you our GPS coordinates. No, you're in the right location. Go around to the other side. Well, there's a concrete barrier across the road there. Well, my EMA director said, that's impossible. I pay for a service that gives me aerial photos of every inch of the county every 6 months, and I'm bringing up those pictures now, and that gate and those barriers aren't there. Well, here they are. He said, wow, your data is better than my data. I said, thank you very much. About a month later, I had the opportunity to provide a briefing to Georgia Emergency Management Agency officials and showed them this picture, and the question came up that said, could you do this from an airplane? We said, yeah, we've wanted to do that, and we're planning to try it. He said, the governor is very interested in flying a plane to an affected area, getting photos, and sending them back as quickly as possible. We said, okay, yeah. How are you doing it now? Well, we have Civil Air Patrol fly the plane. We have someone on board. They snap a picture. And we've got these $5,000 satellite phones. And they can send it back at a whopping 9,600 baud. And they can sometimes send it from the air if they fly straight and level, don't turn, don't hold their mouth wrong. But most of the time they have to land and then send it at 9,600 baud. So we've actually done some tests with that, and I'll show you some of the things that we did with that. As I said, it's an Ethernet connection. You're using a 10 address internally. Each repeater gateway uses the same gateway address, 10.0.0.1. You'll configure it with a known DNS address. For example, just use the Google DNS in that 8.8.8.8, I think it is. The biggest headache in this is that I've got to configure a static IP address for whatever computer I'm using with that assigned 10 address. Now, most of your laptops and everything are set up to go on a network with DHCP, so you got to go in and find out, remember how to do that and set it up. Well, we figured the easier way to do that is put a router in between and program on the WAN side connected to the radio with your static IP address that you're assigned, and then enable DHCP and just walk in with your PC and you're on its network. And that's the configuration that is more often used, and a simple router that is capable of using a 10 address on the LAN side can be used. My favorite, although it's not made, but you can still find them, is the Linksys WRT54GL, running the, replace it with the DDWRT software, firmware. And that works very well. So as you see, you set up a static IP address on the WAN side, set up DHCP, connect. Now, you know, being a wireless router, I can connect with my laptop wirelessly as well, which is I've built a little setup and put it in a Pelican case. And this was after several different times using this, it became evident to me that I need a way that I can have this configuration in a box, take it out, turn it on, use it. Well, I'm on version 3 of this right now because after the Orlando Hamfest and a little episode with batteries, I decided to include a couple of 9-amp-hour batteries in it as well, so it can be self-powered. Now, we actually have one of those setups. It is back there with that. And I'll be connecting to that, time permitting, here at the end. But I want to go over what we did with the aerial photos. Basically, the ID1, we were going into our local D-Star repeater up on the northeast side of Atlanta. Digital camera, GPS unit, airplane with a 1.2 gigahertz antenna, which we configured on an inspection plate on the bottom. This was a Cessna 172. And of course, you need the pilot. We take the picture, we insert GPS data because you want to know where that picture was taken. Some of the newer cameras will insert that into the metadata automatically for you. And we did the quick and dirty way and used the Google Picasa site to upload the pictures to. And that gave us a couple of advantages. And then we also used the DRAT's chat section, since essentially we had an internet session or connection between the airplane and the internet. So if you're using just a standard HT to talk to us back on the ground, it would be very noisy in the cockpit. So we just used DRAT's chat session to say, go here and take a picture. I just uploaded this one to Picasa, go look. Here was our operator, KF4PWI, who's sitting in the back seat with his laptop. You see my ID1 over on the right side of him. And he's there behind the pilot and ready to go and taking pictures. Now, when he uploaded those back to Picasa, you get it as a kind of an album like this. And you won't be able to see much of the pictures, but he took off from the Lawrenceville, Georgia airport, which is up in the northeast suburbs, and flew up to Athens, which was about 45 or 50 miles away. And they even buzzed an airport and took some pictures up there with airport permission. They took some pictures. You'll see stadium pictures, the University of Georgia Stadium. It was empty, fortunately, that day, or they'd probably had Homeland Security on them, buzzing that field. And we had several pictures of facilities along the way. And you can click on those and, of course, get a much larger picture. You can also do thumbnails. And since they had GPS data encoded in the metadata, you can see where those pictures were taken on the map, on a Google map, and you can click on any one of those and get the picture. Now, what is a feature if you do it this way? Everyone's used Google Earth, or you go to Google Maps and you click on the satellite button and you see a picture of that area. This gives you a before and after, because you can compare the new picture, which in this case might be a damaged area, with the old picture of what it should look like before. And so that can help with damage assessment for emergency agencies. For example, here was the before picture, and we had the after picture that, in this case, there was no damage. There was also no one in the stadium. I'm going to try this real quick. How much time do I have?
5 minutes.
About 5 minutes. Let's try this real quick, if I can. And I want to show you. Now, we have the setup in the back that I was talking about. It's an ID1 radio. It's talking to the repeater that's over in the demo room. And it is connected to the internet through a cellular modem. So we're simulating that I'm out in the field somewhere, and I'm going to first connect to the back and my router in the back. Right now I'm connected to my MiFi card over there, but I'm going to actually connect to that router, which has D-Star as its SSID, and so as it's coming up and everything will lock in, I will have there, I am connected. So I'm going to go to a website, and I've already set a home page so I don't come up with one that's real high graphics and everything, but I'm going to start up, and it's going to show me a reflector page, and it brought up that page. I am actually communicating wirelessly to that router, wireless router in the back. It is going by 1.2 gigahertz across the hall, short hall, and into the internet. So I have internet connectivity via amateur radio and Wi-Fi in this connection. So it's a way to get you connection field. We have an Aries communications trailer that we've just built. We have an ID1 radio in it. We use that when we're in areas where we can get a 1.2 signal. We'll use it to give us, not fast, but 128 kilobit internet connectivity for our Aries trailer, and we can be totally self-sufficient. That's really, that's all I have, and if there are any questions, I'll try to entertain those.
Just to understand, this page you just demonstrated, this was still the 1200 baud channel back to here?
No, this is on the 128 kilobits.
Okay, so that walkie-talkie can do the 128 kilobits?
No. When you're on the 2 meter 440, you're only transmitting 1200 baud, right, packet type speeds. I'm going Wi-Fi to the wireless router back there, and then it's going over the 1.2 radio to the repeater. There was a question up here.
When you were talking about the 1200 bit per second, you were complaining that it's not protected with some kind of error correction. What's the story at 128 kilobits per second?
Your standard internet protocol at that point, so it's IP based.
Oh.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
I have a comment.
Oh, a comment.
I can save you a little bit of time. The D-Rats, Dan, as far as the TNC goes, what he's implemented is KISS mode. So all you can do is send UI frames back and forth. There's no AX25 stack or anything like that built in.
Are you sure he's got, I understood on the latest versions that there was a limited implementation of AX25?
I'm not, as far as I know, I'm running the latest version.
Okay.
And all it does is UI frames back and forth.
Well, I'm definitely...
To be my guest, try it out yourself, but...
I definitely want to, because I think that could be very powerful, and I've been bugging him off and on to try to do that, because... you know, there are very few programs out there that will do everything that his does in one application. And so no matter whether you're on packet or internet or D-Star, if you could run a common program, I just think that would be very, very powerful. Thank you very much.